What's up, everybody? Today, I want to go over 5 tips for success in technical interviews pertaining to computer science and programming. I've been through many tech interviews at major companies and small companies, and I think I know 5 tips that can really help you guys. They're really simple and really easy to listen to. Let's get started with my first tip.
Wait, SpongeBob! We're not cavemen! We have technology!
But to get a professional job, you want to look professional. You know, people judge you by how you look. It's not nice, necessarily, but you want to say, I want this job, and look like you want this job. So just very important, dress very well. Even if it's a Zoom interview, even if the interview is not in person, you want to make sure that, you know, you are clear in how you look and what you're saying, and you want to be professional in every aspect of that. It's very important to dress for success. The next tip, number 2, is to communicate with your interviewer. So in your technical interviewer, you're gonna have behavioral questions and you're gonna have some engineering problems where you're gonna have to code a problem that likely they ask many candidates, and they're gonna compare your results to other people. Now, I do mock interviews for many of my clients, and one thing I see a lot is that people fail to communicate. What I mean by that is that when you are going through a technical problem, talk with your interviewer. Say, these are the cases I assume. Talk about a null case. Talk about maybe like an infinite case. What I mean by that is when you plug in null to their possible parameters, or you plug in maybe some like array that's too big to their possible parameters, depending on their problem. And you show that you're thinking of edge cases. Show the interviewer what solution you are thinking of as you develop the problem. It's not good to just think all in your head, get the perfect solution, and then suddenly write it down. Even if it's right, the reason you want to communicate is because you want to imagine you're going to work with this person. It may not be this exact person interviewing you, but it's going to be someone at the company, and they want to see you are a great person to work with. You're going to be solving many problems working for a company, problems that maybe you don't know firsthand how to do, problems that you may need help on, and they want to see that you're a good communicator and that you're able to help other people out, or other people able to talk to you, maybe tell you where you made a mistake, and improve upon yourself so that you can solve problems easier and better next time. So being a good communicator, not just the best engineer problem solver, is very important. It's very good to tell the interviewer what you're thinking and not stay quiet the whole time and think everything in your head. You want to make sure that the journey of problem solving, you take the people in the room along with you, either draw pictures or visually talk to them. It's good to look people in the eye and make hand suggestions as well. It just shows you're more communicative. Number 3, and this is a big one too, is you want to understand if a problem can be improved, and this can be very difficult, so listen closely. Often when I do mock interviews, and often when I have real interviews, what happens is that an interviewer gives a problem that what I call has 3 solutions. All of them programmatically give the same answer, but the answer can be improved in terms of efficiency and time and space. So maybe you can make the answer more efficient, you can make it faster. So you could take a solution that is n squared and make it linear logarithmic, or maybe you can make it constant time using a different data structure. So often this can be very difficult. So let's say you complete a problem and the solution is n squared. You use one nested for loop, for example. The interviewer may say, is there anything we can do to improve this problem? And what he's saying is that you're not done with this problem. A lot of times if you give a satisfactory answer, they will just move on to the next problem or tell you the interview's done, and then you know you've done really well. But what they're saying is, can you think better about this problem? Can you think of a more efficient way to solve this problem? Maybe there's a data structure we could use that would make this problem easier. And this can be very difficult. I know I have failed in this situation before, because usually you need to start from scratch again. Because if you took this method to solve a problem and it's less efficient than the way it's solved, usually you need a completely different approach to solve the same problem, but more efficiently. And so sometimes you have to start from scratch, and that's what I would actually recommend, is that if someone asks you to possibly solve the problem faster, you completely wipe your old way of thinking and try, and this can be very hard in a tense interview situation and try to think, is there a better data structure I can use? Can I use a hash table instead of a linked list in this situation? Or whatever that may be. Number four, know big O notation. It's really important to understand space and time efficiency of your algorithms. Being able to tell your interviewer what the space and time complexity of your algorithm is and how changing it would affect your big O notation. If you don't know about big O notation, I have a card in the top right you can click to learn more about that. It's a computer science concept that a lot of interviewers like to see. I've never not been an interviewer where someone didn't ask me what the big O notation of my problem was. So it's just something very important to understand. It's usually very easy to get. It's just knowing as your data size grows towards infinity, how much time and size this algorithm will take up. Number five is a very simple one, but yet important, is practice the coding and the interview beforehand in the environment you will be coding in. What I mean by that is that if you have a whiteboard interview where you have to write code without a keyboard, without autocomplete, without a syntax analyzer, please practice writing on a whiteboard. If you can't do that, write on a piece of paper. A lot of people, if they're taken out of an environment without, you know, an auto-completion machine and a syntax analyzer, they start making stupid mistakes like forgetting semicolons, forgetting braces, and forgetting all the simple things that the computer may just either warn you about or do for you automatically with a click of the button. It's very important to make sure your test environment is as good as your actual interview environment. If you don't know, try to email the recruiter beforehand and ask them, maybe it's a Google document, maybe, you know, it's a whiteboard, maybe, you know, it's a Zoom call and you have to verbally explain it to them. It's just very important to practice how the interview will go. I know you may not think this may be applicable to any other situation other than this interview, but it's good to be prepared, as the Boy Scouts will say. So make sure you actually get the muscle memory of writing down code by hand if you've never done it before. I've seen a lot of people not able to take it from their computer to their hand, even though they're a good coder, just because they don't realize how much of a crutch autocomplete is. If you want a paid private call to improve your programming or interview skills, my email's in the description below. I've helped out many clients. Also, do a great job if you like and subscribe to this video. Love you guys. Have the best day of your life.